अंधस्य ज्ञानांजनशलाकाय चक्षुरोन्मिलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः नमा ओं विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदांत स्वामी इति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देश तारिणे वांचा कल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपा सिंधुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधार श्रीवासादि गौर भक्तवृंद हरे कृष्णा 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 हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे Hare Krishna. Thank you very much for coming today evening. And I'll be speaking on the pastimes of Lord Ram, especially when he was in exile. So the topic is at home in exile. Ram in the forest. I have written one book on the Ramayana and I'm writing a second book on it. So I've been contemplating some of the pastimes of Lord Ram deeply, and the theme that I'll take over here is that acceptance and diligence take us to transcendence. That by accepting things and by being diligent about things, we can rise above our situations, we can go to transcendence. So the broad theme will be acceptance and diligence to transcendence. And in this session, we'll have two sessions, now from till around 6:15, and probably around 7:15 till 8:45, 9. Now, this session, I'll focus primarily on acceptance. And the second part, I'll focus on diligence. And I'll be taking three main points. And since we are having two sessions, so I would like it if you could reflect and speak some points. Say, I'll speak for 15 minutes. About acceptance, I'll be speaking three points. So after each point, you can reflect and tell some point which you found striking is a carry home for you as something which you would like to share with someone else. So that way, we'll make it a little more interactive. And we can have question answers also, but first some reflections and then some questions. So all of us have times when things just don't go according to our will. We want to do something, we plan to do something, and it just doesn't work out. So, right now I'm supposed to go from here to New Zealand, but the New Zealand visa is not getting processed. So, I applied about more than 40 days ago, but they're saying it will take 71 days. So, I'll be in America by the time I get the visa to New Zealand. So, when we make a plan and it doesn't work, it's annoying. But I was thinking about it, that it's just that I want to visit New Zealand for a few days. And just when that plan is not working out, I'm getting annoyed with it. But it's one visit not working out. But imagine if you're staying somewhere and suddenly you're kicked out of that place. And it sometimes happens, you know, we are staying in a house and we are evicted, if you are a tenant in that house and the landlord says you have to leave this house. At least they give some time, maybe one month or something like that. Some decent amount of time is there. But if suddenly we are told you have to get out of this house, even getting out of a house, we may have some friends also at whose place we can go, some relatives we can go. Still, it will be so agitating for us. What to speak of if somebody is told to get out of a country itself. Sometime nowadays, it's happening in America. I was at a devotee's house, or I was supposed to go to a devotee's house. I was going to stay at their place. And then I was traveling from one city to another. When I was going to go to that city, I was going to stay at their place. And about 5-6 days before, that devotee called me and said, I'm sorry, I can't host you. I said, that's okay, but what is the matter? He said, we ourselves don't have a home now. What do you mean? He said, he was applying for his H-1B visa and that extension didn't happen. So he was planning to host me and organize my program, but before my programs, he had to leave the country. So there's so much insecurity, and you know, he had his whole life over there. He had his job, his family, his children getting education. Suddenly he had to leave. But even when he had to leave, yeah, he was Indian staying in America, he could go to India. He had his parents, his larger family, he had his property in India. But imagine if somebody is evicted from a country, and it's like, say we are immigrant, many of us are immigrants in a particular country. And then if you have to go back, we have our home country to go to. But if somebody is evicted from their home country itself, and they cannot go to any other country, they just have to go somewhere in a forest and live. Sometimes there are some adventure stories about how somebody is stranded on an island and then they try to learn to survive on that island. You know, that is, it all sounds very good in adventure. But just the situation that suddenly at one moment, you have to just leave your home and go. And generally, when we have to accept something unfavorable or something unpleasant, the magnitude of how unpleasant it is depends on how pleasant our present situation is. Like if we are having a job that is bad and we are fired from that job, we won't feel that bad, it's good riddance. But Ram was the king of Ayodhya. He was a member of the royal family, is going to become the king. So he had everything right. It was not just that he had a house and a job. He had a kingdom. And suddenly, one moment, he had to just leave everything and go to the forest, to exile where he had nothing. So just trying to process something like this, we all need to process change in life. Say all of you are sitting and hearing. And for you to sit and hear, a certain amount of stability and structure is required. All of you have reasonable confidence that while you are sitting, the person sitting again next to you is not suddenly going to punch you on the nose. So, you know, if you didn't know who was sitting next to you, or if you didn't have that much level of trust in the person sitting next to you, then maybe you'll be looking half at the speaker, look at half at the person. So, we all do need to process change in life. But there is a certain amount of structure and stability that is required for us to function. And the less the structure and stability, the more difficult it becomes for us to function. So, as I said, if we are afraid that some person next to us might hit us, then we would function, but most of our functioning would be focused on guarding ourselves. We'd not be able to do anything else. So generally, when change comes up, change consumes our attention. Because we have to deal with it. Or even if change is not coming up, change is likely to come up. Then also, we have to deal with it, and that consumes our attention. And the more unexpected or the more massive the change, the more difficult it is to accept it. So now, it's very difficult, actually, apart from sudden death. There's so very little that can be a change like this. At one moment, you're a member of the ruling family, and at the next moment, just out into the forest. With nothing. In fact, later on when Bharat is back and Bharat hears that Ram has been exiled to the forest, he's shocked. He said that Ram cannot even conceive doing anything wrong. And exile is a punishment reserved for the worst of criminals. It is only one level below execution. The worst crime is punished with capital punishment. But just one level below is exile. It means everything except your life is taken away from you. So how does one process something like this? Oh, there are times when things change against our will, and our capacity to deal with that situation, that determines whether we'll be able to move forward in it or not. Some people just can't deal with it. So when Ram had to go through this sudden change, one moment royal prince, the next moment a destitute exilee, that's a huge change. And when such change happens, most of our energy goes in processing, in the sense of, how can this happen? We just can't accept it. So the first point I'm discussing is that the greater the magnitude and the unexpectedness of the change, the more difficult it is to accept it. The more unexpected and the more massive, then it's that much more difficult to accept it. Say, if a student goes for an exam, it's a maths exam, and the paper is more difficult than they expected. It's a little, it's okay. How to deal with this? But they go for a maths exam, and they get an English paper. Hey, what is this? This is not fair. So when we go for a particular exam, we have a certain expectation. This is what should be come in the exam. But something else entirely comes. If it's a little more difficult paper, the student can take it. Okay, it's my bad luck. It's one thing to say something is bad luck, but if a completely different paper only comes, well, this is unfair, this is not right. This should not be happening. So what happens? Life tests us in any subject at any time. So life tests us in any subject at any time. And that's why it can be extremely difficult. And now, at such times, acceptance is vital. Now, we may say, okay, but I don't want to do this. Okay, somebody may say, like, somebody is, their visa extension doesn't get sanctioned. They just have to leave the country. Say, I won't leave the country. Well, unless you want to become an undocumented immigrant, you have to leave the country. So, of course, undocumented immigrant is the American politically correct word. Undocumented worker for a person who is staying illegally. So, anyway, if one doesn't want to do that, then one has to accept. And even if somebody decides, I'm going to stay in the country illegally, still they will have to accept that now I have to do a lot of covert activities. I have to conceal my so many things so that I can continue. So basically, when the world around us changes, acceptance is vital. Say, if we are not able to accept, then we keep wasting our energy futilely. Suppose somebody wanted to learn rowing. And they went and took some rowing lessons and they learned rowing. And then they called all their friends. When somebody learns some new skills, they want to exhibit their skills to their friends. And they call all their friends and relatives, see how nicely I'm rowing. And they have their whole dream in their mind. You know, I'll row gracefully, and the boat will move swiftly, and people will click my photos, people will click the videos, and they'll share it on social media, and everybody will praise me. And then they get into that boat, and they start rowing, and suddenly, out of nowhere, a monster wave comes. The monster wave hits, and hits so suddenly and so forcefully, at the next moment, there is no boat, and there are no oars. They have been knocked out of the boat, and the oars have also been knocked out of their hands. Now, if at that time, they still, oh, I want my photo to be clicked. And they keep rowing. Well, if they keep rowing, what will happen? What do you think will happen? They'll drown. They want to keep rowing, but there is no boat and there are no oars. So at that time, they have to accept, okay, these things have changed. So now I have to paddle, I have to swim, and I have to somehow get to the coast first. And later on, I may do this again. So with respect to a physically threatening situation like this, it's easy to understand that we need to do course correction. What are you rowing now? Get out first. Nobody would be so stupid as to keep rowing over there. But when it comes not so much to physically threatening situations, but to emotionally threatening situations, then we often find it much more difficult to accept. So sometimes things have changed so much, and metaphorically speaking, we are keeping rowing. We are rowing. Well, there's no boat, there are no oars. Why are you rowing? So imagine that, say, somebody is giving a class. And somehow, say, if I come and give a class, and I speak in a language that nobody understands over here. So now, once it happened to me that I had gone for a program, and they had told me you had to speak in English. I prepared a whole class in English. When I reached there, the organization that had called us, they just wanted, because ISKCON was a big name, they wanted somebody from ISKCON to come. And there, nobody could understand English at all. So I had suspected something, because when I had got the brochure was filled with English typos. There are many typing mistakes. So I thought, you know, they're having an English program, but the brochure is not written properly. But I thought, okay, you know, maybe. In India, grammar is often treated with a chalta hai attitude. So I thought maybe it's okay. But then when I got there, I had prepared a whole class. It was actually an interfaith meeting. I had prepared the whole class, and when I got there, it was something which, there are many of the concepts were such that I couldn't even speak them in Hindi. There's one, I remember one sentence I tried to speak, and then after I spoke that in Hindi, so I was thinking in English and speaking in Hindi. So I wanted to make the point that when some religions become aggressive against other religions, so outer aggression is a distorted expression of inner insecurity. So I spoke that in Hindi. Bahaya akramakta ye antarang asurakshitta ka ek vikrut prakatikaran hai. I was seeing all blank faces. Then I realized, you know, I have to change tack. I cannot speak all this. I had a 10-minute presentation. For at least three, four minutes, it's like I was rowing. There was no boat and there are no oars. Then I realized I have to change tack. Now I have to swim. So for all of us, when we are put in situations that we can't accept, or that we didn't expect, first of all, then unless we accept that, we can't deal with the situation effectively. Whatever we do simply makes things worse. So lack of acceptance prevents us from acting effectively. Rather, lack of acceptance pushes us to act unproductively, counterproductively. Unproductivity is no good effect. Counterproductive is bad effect, actually. You keep rowing, not only they're not going to exhibit the skills, but you're going to drown. So what happens is that we all need to learn this very vital art of acceptance. So it is only when we accept that we can deal with the things as they are. So this was the first point I was going to make. So Lord Ram, is how he was able to accept. We'll discuss this briefly now. But the point that this is such a huge magnitude of change, he suddenly had to accept. And it is remarkable that he was able to accept it. So any points, any reflections? Anything that's any example or any point that struck you? Yes, Shashi Guru.
Acceptance is hard to come. And even if it comes somehow, it's harder to stay. So, what do you say about
that? Is this a reflection or a question?
No question, because.
Okay, it's a question.
Things like these keep on happening.
Yeah.
And the first problem which comes is to remember that acceptance is important. Somehow, even if it comes, then it doesn't stay for long because the fear overtakes the acceptance.
Okay, yeah, okay. So, can I come back to you? Any reflections before we move forwards? I'll have questions. Yes, please.
Prabhu, so when it comes to things, especially the material aspects.
It's a reflection, no? It's not a question. Okay, yeah, okay.
Like you mentioned last time, holding on to things lightly but not lightly, and having that frame of mind will help.
Okay, good point. So we hold on to our plans lightly, not tightly. Yes, we make our plans and we would like to actualize our plans, but we hold on to them lightly, not tightly. So that is, that to the extent we are attached to our plans or our expectations, to that extent, acceptance becomes difficult. To the extent we are not that attached, to that extent, acceptance will become easy. That's a good point. Thank you. Any one more reflection? Then we can move on with questions. Yes, Chaitanya.
Physically challenged situations, changes are easy to deal with instead of mentally challenged situations.
Yes. Physically challenging situations are more easier to accept than emotionally challenging situations. So it's like, say, if a limb is broken, and it's painful to accept. I was walking healthily, I was moving healthily. But it's okay, I can accept it. I have to move on with it. But suppose, say, we are emotionally broken down because our relationship is in trouble, some big dream is not working out, then that becomes much more difficult to accept. To a large extent, we function at the physical level. So when physically something is wrong, we see it and we can't deny it that much. But when emotionally something is wrong, for a long time we stay in denial. Or we try to stay in denial. No, no, it's not like this, it's like this. It's okay, it's bad, but it's not that bad. So denial is the opposite of acceptance. Say, I was in Canada, in Calgary, so they had to, the university there had asked me to speak on death and death rituals in Hinduism. So it was an unusual topic. So the idea was that they were studying the whole topic of thanatology, study of death, and there they were studying how death is accepted, or how is death dealt with in different traditions. So Hinduism, they wanted me to speak. So one of the questions that came up was that there was this boy asked, isn't it, if you allowed someone throughout your life, how can you burn their body? How can you suddenly stop loving them? Isn't it brutal to just set their body on fire like that? Isn't it much more dignified to actually put their body in a coffin and then bury it properly? So, Sid, I explained that their every action has a worldview behind it. But one aspect of the ritual of burning the body on death and seeing the body burning, that is, it helps bring closure. Because when somebody near to us dies, it takes a long time to accept it also. This person was there with me, suddenly they're gone. So when that physically graphic activity is seen, the body is there and the body is burning and it is reduced to ashes. So then that It's definitely graphic, but it in a forceful way gets us out of denial. And in a forceful way, by making it's clear this body is gone now. This relationship is for this lifetime, it is over now. Then it helps to bring closure. That's why something which is emotionally traumatic, having some physical gestures or physical actions that signify the end of that signify the conclusion or the termination of that can help us to bring closure. So when something is simply emotional, if you do something physical with it, then that helps us to bring closure. So that's a sobering point, but thank you for that. Okay. Yes, Muralidhar Prabhu. So Muralidhar Prabhu has come from Perth to Melbourne because he got reports that in the last 2-3 visits I created a lot of trouble in his absence. So he's come to monitor me now. Thank you. Yes, Prabhu.
Yes, sir. I struggle with this idea of let go versus giving up.
Okay. Yes, that is going to be the third point in this discussion. I'll talk about different acceptance at different levels. I'll talk about it. Thank you. Yes, Shashi Prabhu, we'll come to your question now. Acceptance is hard to have and acceptance is difficult to maintain also. So what do we do about it? Yes, actually even that was my second point. So let me move on to that. So I repeat, the first point was that the more unexpected and the more greater the change, it's difficult to accept. But if we don't accept, we waste our energy. Then, now, acceptance can be broadly with three perspectives. Acceptance can be because of powerlessness. Acceptance can be because of temporariness. And acceptance can be because of purposefulness. Now, there can be many categories within this also. But let's give some examples to illustrate this. Say, if we immigrate to a place where it's extremely cold. And there's just nothing we can do about it. So we're powerless to do anything about it. So although it takes time, but when we struggle, and we realize, I can't do anything about it, we come to some level of acceptance. Okay, this has happened now. Now, often when the acceptance comes because of powerlessness, because of sense of power, I can't change it, so I accept it. And still, it's not really genuine acceptance. Because still, when the acceptance comes because of powerlessness, there is still a strong sense of resentfulness. It should not be like this. But it is like this. So, still, there is some acceptance. There may be a lot of anger, a lot of resentment, but I accept it. Why? Because I can't do anything about it. And acknowledging that I can't do anything about it also requires some amount of humility and maturity. Again, with respect to physical things, it's easier to accept. If my hand is broken, well, I understand it is broken. I can't do anything about it. But if something more subtler is broken, you may think, no, it's not broken. It's okay. It's still there. So acceptance at the first level can be because of powerlessness. Just the situation is so big, so overwhelming, I can't do anything about it. But even this is good. So we see, okay, this is much bigger and I am much smaller. I can't do much about it. That is one level of acceptance. So this, here when I'm talking about acceptance, I'm talking about changing our consciousness. So when we accept with powerlessness, what we understand is that this is bigger than what I thought, or I am smaller than what I thought. I thought I could just get rid of this, but I can't. Like Gajendra in the 8th canto of the Srimad Bhagavatam, when the crocodile caught him. Initially, that was just an annoyance. What is this crocodile? Where does it come from? He was just having a party. He was enjoying. And then suddenly this crocodile came and caught him. Where did this come from? Just tossed it away. He tossed it away and he thought it'll go away, but it didn't go away. Look at it. Again tossed it away. Again, He stayed over there. And then he realized this is not an annoyance. This is a threat. I started combating, I started fighting with it. But then eventually, he realized that this is not just a threat, this is a disaster, this is a catastrophe. He's fighting, fighting, fighting. But eventually, he realized I am powerless. So for all of us, sometimes problems come like that crocodile. When they come, initially, like no big deal. It's okay. This doesn't matter. So when that happens, I'll just shake it off. But it keeps holding on to us. And we realize, hey, I can't do anything about it. So initially, what was he doing? He was underestimating the power of that crocodile and overestimating his own power. But as that battle went on, what happened? He realized that this crocodile is stronger than what I thought, and I am not as strong as I thought. So acceptance can come because of powerlessness. There's just nothing I can do about it. And at some levels, say like, as I said, the example of somebody suddenly having to leave a country or somebody not being able to enter a country. Yes, there are forces bigger than me, so I have to accept it. This also requires humility and maturity. Otherwise, if we are too egoistic, we find it very difficult to accept it. The second level was what? Acceptance because of? Does anyone remember? Temporariness. So, if we don't want it, but say we get into a metro, say a local in Mumbai. The compartment is for 50 people and there are 300 people in it. And then now we are crowded, squeezing everyone. And we don't like it. We don't want it. But, okay, it's a half hour, 45 minute. I have to stand in the crowd to get squeezed. But it's okay. So when we understand that this is temporary, that also allows us to gain acceptance. This is there, this is unpleasant, but this is not forever. Now, this is the level at which Krishna recommends Arjuna to have tolerance. Now, tolerance is another word for acceptance. The way Krishna uses the word tolerance is in the sense of acceptance. Just live with it. So, Krishna first says that you are spiritual, you are eternal. Dehinosmin yatha dehe kaumaram yavanam jara tatha dehantara praptir dhiras tatra namuyati. And the next verse, many of us know it, so you can recite it after me. Matra sparshastu kaunteya. Matra sparshastu kaunteya. Shitoshna sukhadukhadaha. Shitoshna sukhadukhadaha. Agama paino nityas. Paino nityas. Tam stitikshasva bharata. So he's saying, agam apayino anityas. This is temporary. Even that is temporary, hopefully. Yeah, but that's a good example. Many times, things are temporary, but we don't know how temporary they are. We know a child is not going to cry forever, but we don't know how long they're going to cry. But sometimes when we face problems, they say, okay, I know it's not going to last forever, but how long? If I know it, I can tolerate it. But if I don't know, it becomes more difficult. So, agam apayino anityas. Krishna says, when this beginning and it's temporary. Therefore, tams titikshasva. Therefore, tolerate it. So, tolerance can come by, in a sense, seeing the big picture. That, okay, this is temporary, but there's going to be a bigger life, there's a much longer I'm going to live. So I can tolerate it. To some extent, when something bad happens to us, the more we are attached to something, the more that consumes our vision. So we just can't think of anything other than that attachment. And because we can't think of anything other than that attachment, so even if it is temporary, we can't let go of it. Say suppose there is a sports match. Say there is India-Pakistan match. And you know, there's a very intense, tough match, and say one particular team loses. Now, some players in that team may say, it's terrible. They were devastated. They just sink down in gloom. And some others may say, it's just a match. It's a match. They had a better day than us, so they won. Whatever. So now you'll see that. Now some people may say, this is the end of the world. How could we have lost this match? Some others may say, okay, yeah, we really wanted to win, but it's after all a game. It's a match. No need to catastrophize it. So it's a matter of perspective. But the more somebody is attached to winning, everybody wants to win, no doubt. But the more somebody is consumed by winning, the more it is difficult to accept if one loses. But if one is more attached to, say, playing well, if I don't win today, I'll win tomorrow. Okay, I lost this match, but maybe tomorrow's match I will win. Then it becomes easier to accept. So you could say that attachment shrinks our vision. So the more attached we are, we just can't see beyond the present situation. Whereas detachment expands our vision. We detach, okay, yes. Now, this detachment is not giving up. I'll talk about that a little later. But this detachment is, okay, we didn't play as well in this match, or they played better than us. So let's move to the next match. So one way we can get acceptance is by recognizing that whatever has gone wrong is temporary. It may be terribly wrong, but it is temporary. Now, in the case of Ram, how long was he exiled? 14 years. And when Ram was consoling Kausalya, he said that, oh mother, 14 years will go away just like 14 days. He said, I'll go to the forest, and before you know it, I'll be back. Don't lament. Kausalya was so devastated. She said that, actually, although I was the senior most queen, but after Dashrath married Kaikeyi, she became his favorite queen. And I was neglected and slighted because of that. I tolerated, I endured it all. And my hope was that I would have a child. And then when I had a child, after long austerities, I had a child like you. It fulfilled my dreams. And when you grew up to become such an illustrious person, illustrious warrior, illustrious prince, all my dreams were that you will become the king. But now that you are being exiled to the forest, again, I will experience all the slights and the neglects and the insults. I can't live here. He says, let me come to the forest with you. So Ram, first argument he uses is that actually 14 years, it'll just go away quickly. Now, Kausalya says, 14 years? He says, every single day will be like 14 years for me. So I cannot live without you. Then, at that time, Ram tells her that your duty right now is next to you, my father. He says, my father, when I met him, I saw that he was extremely distressed. He felt betrayed by Kaikeyi. He's not sending me to the forest with joy. He's sending me with great pain to the forest. And when he has been betrayed by one wife, if at that time he's abandoned and rejected by another queen, says, it'll be impossible for him to be here. He said, you need to be with him. So Ram here gave Kaikeyi a sense of purposefulness. I said acceptance can come from three levels. Come from helplessness or powerlessness, from temporariness and purposefulness. So he helped Kaikeyi, or rather not Kaikeyi, Kausalya, to shift her vision of Dashrath. That instead of seeing Dashrath, seeing that, oh, Dashrath is sending my son away, He helped us see not as a perpetrator, but as a victim or as a co-victim. That he is hurt by what has happened. In fact, everything that Ram does is amazing over there. After he is banished, he hears that when actually that night, Kaikeyi demands that the next day Ram is to be coronated. And the previous night, Kaikeyi demands from Dashrath, and Dashrath is so shocked. He can't believe it. He faints when he comes back and he sees Kaikeyi's cold, expectant eyes, demanding eyes. He realizes it's not a nightmare, it's a reality. And he falls at her feet and begs her. He says, you can take everything from me, but don't ask for this. And finally he says that, if you want Bharat to be the king, let Bharat be the king. But don't ask Ram to go to the forest. He says, what way has Ram wronged you? I can't live without him. But Mantara has told Kaikeyi that as long as Ram is in the kingdom, Bharat, even if he comes back, Bharat will not accept the kingship. And even if Bharat accepts, the remaining citizens will not accept. You have to demand as firmly that Ram should go to the forest and Bharat should become the king, Prince Regent. So Kaikeyi is unmoved. And finally, when Ram is summoned to that assembly, to Kaikeyi's palace where Dashrath is there, at that time Ram comes and he sees his father is disheveled, is distressed, is. And when you come to a room, there are two people sitting in the room and there is some tension among them. You can immediately sense that. And if two people are having a good relationship, they may just glance at each other, they may be friendly, they smile. But if two people are having a tense relationship, they talk about the other person without even looking at that person. Or they look, but they look with as if they want to burn the other person. So it's easy to sense. If you're coming to a room and there are some unpleasant vibrations over there. So Ram senses this, and he's just come from a very, he's come with the expectation that now he's going to be coronated, and it's a very cheerful mood in Ayodhya. And immediately, he recalibrates what's happening. And then he asks his father, and Dashrath Maharaj is so shattered. He thinks, the son whom I was meant to protect, the son whom I was meant to give the kingdom, how can I tell him to go to the forest? Actually, Dashrath Maharaj never speaks the words. And Ram asks, Dashrath just stays silent. And then Ram turns to Kaikeyi and asks her, oh, Mother Kaikeyi, what is the matter? My father seems to be greatly distressed. Please tell me. And then Kaikeyi says that, he has something to tell you, which he feels will cause you great distress. And that is why he is hesitant to tell you. Steel yourself so that you can hear these words. And then he says, please don't hesitate, tell me whatever it is. If I can do anything to remove the distress of my father, I will do it immediately. And then she says, that based on two promises that he had given me long ago, he has decided that Bharat will become the prince regent and then the king, and you will go to the forest in exile for 14 years. These are two devastating news. But Ram stays composed, unaffected. And then normally, when something as terrible or as unfair like this happens and we are supposed to tell someone, then we expect that person to protest. We expect that person to maybe counterattack also. So Kaikeyi is preparing for that. Now Ram will protest. But Ram says that, oh, Mother Kaikeyi, you know, I always treated you like my mother. And I thought you also accepted me like your son. But today, it causes me great sadness to know that you never accepted me as your son. Now, Kaikai may think that. Here he will say, you know, how can you treat a son like this? I treated you like a mother, and is this what how you treat your son? But Ram, when Ram sees that there's hostility, his whole effort is to decrease the tension. So he says, if you had truly accepted me as your son, then for such an insignificant thing as a kingdom, you wouldn't even have needed to go to my father. You could just have told me, and I would have given the kingdom to Bharat. Now, Kaikeyi is shocked. Now, what is this? Is the more, see, if we are materialistic, we think that everyone else is materialistic. If we are power hungry, we think that everyone else is power hungry. And she just can't compute. How can anybody think like this? Is there some false move, some trick over here? And he says, then he turns to his father. Oh, father, I'll prepare now to go to the forest. And before leaving, I'll come and take your blessings. And very calmly, Ram walks out of it. And as he walks out, he's come in the royal chariot. But he walks out on foot. And he goes towards his own palace. And when he goes there, everybody is puzzled. The courtiers who had come with him. And then this kind of news can't stay hidden for long. It is said that walls have ears. And palace walls have very big ears. So whatever happens in a palace, in the smallest of things, there are so many people who are ready to tell about it. So the news starts spreading everywhere. And of course, people tell each other, but nobody tells it to the directly affected parties. So Sita, Lakshman, Kaushalya, all of them, Ram himself has to tell it. And throughout it all, what Ram does is, that instead of saying, you know, what unfair thing has happened to me? How dare something like this happen to me? This is so outrageous. He basically just helps everybody to come to a level of acceptance for it. He accepts it and he helps everyone to come to the level of acceptance. So, especially instructive is, I'll discuss about some of the incidents gradually, but let's focus on the theme of purposefulness a little bit. So I talked about how Ram gave Kaushalya a sense of purposefulness. You know, your husband needs you right now. You need to be with him. So, that way he gave her a sense of purpose. Similarly, how did he himself accept it? What was his sense of purpose? So later on, when he is having a very strong argument with Lakshman, which I'll come to later, but at this point, that when Lakshman says, how can you accept this? So Ram says that it was as my duty to my father, as per his will, I was ready to ascend the throne. Now, as a duty to my father, he wants me to go to the forest, so I'll go to the forest. So here, what happened is, acceptance was easier for him because his purpose was clear. If his purpose had been to get to the throne, then that purpose would have been completely thwarted. It's unacceptable. It's utterly unacceptable. Now we have Ram ready to just go to the forest for just honor the word of his father. Just before I came here, we had brought some, we had taken a group of about 25 Americans to a tour of Vrindavan. These were Americans who had not even gone to ISKCON temple in America, completely new yogis. And for people outside India, one of the biggest attractions of India is Taj Mahal. So they wanted to go to Taj Mahal. So now, I've been in India, I've never been to Taj Mahal. But, I said that, you know, we will take you to Vrindavan, you can go to Taj Mahal. He said, no, we want you to be our guide to Taj Mahal also. I said, So I was wondering, we were having talks at different places with Dawar, what do you talk about in Taj Mahal? But of course I talked about love and selflessness. So at that time, if you consider, there were Shahjahan and Aurangzeb. So what happened is that Aurangzeb, he took his father when he was alive and imprisoned him so that he could become the king. But what did Ram do? Ram exiled himself so that he could please his father. So it is the same Indian history, but Yanisha Sarva Bhutanam Tasyam Jagrati Sayyam. Completely opposite values. So here, the point is that Ram, how was he able to accept it? So for Aurangzeb, his purpose was, I want to become the king. And if my father is coming in the way, get him out of the way. But for Ram, his purpose was not to become the king. His purpose was to serve his father. And because of that purpose of serving his father, okay, I serve this way or I serve this way. So acceptance comes easier when we have a deeper purpose. I'll talk about purposefulness more when we talk about diligence in the second session. But acceptance can come from purposefulness. Say, it sometimes happens when I'm traveling. So, say I go to a particular place and I'm supposed to give some programs. And some senior devotee comes over there, maybe some sannyasi, some guru comes over there. And once it happened that I was there at a place in America, and then at that time, so my programs, I usually plan 3-4 months before. But, so it's like, there are different levels of preachers also. So some of us, of traveling preachers, we are like at the level of Vaidhi Bhakti. So the gurus and sannyasis, they are at the level of Raganuga Bhakti. They can plan any time to come anywhere and everything is arranged for them. So sometimes it happens that I was at this place and then there are 3-4 programs organized for me, and then some other senior devotee came there, prominent leader, sannyasi guru of our movement. So the temple president was there, he said that, you know, I'm sorry that we had organized all these programs, but he has come, so he'll have to give the class. I said, he says, wonderful. I said, you know, I have heard his classes on YouTube. I would love to meet him. I would love to hear his classes. So he was a little relieved. He said, I was actually nervous. I said that, yeah, he told me that that some other preacher who had come over there previously, and someone else had come over there. So that preacher got so well. I said, I planned for months and you just disrupt the whole plans. So then I was thinking that how was I able to accept? It's not that I'm a very advanced, but I realized that because this devotee, the senior Vaishnava, the person whom I respected and whose association I also looked forward to. So if my purpose, at that, now it's not that I always have a high purpose, but at that time I was able to accept because my purpose in traveling is to not just speak about Krishna, but also to absorb myself in Krishna. So one way of absorbing is by speaking. In fact, I find speaking the most absorbing way. But hearing about Krishna is also absorbing. And because this devotee's classes, I liked them, so I knew that I can absorb myself in Krishna. If my purpose is only to speak about Krishna, then if I don't get an opportunity to speak, he says, what is this? It will be a little more difficult to accept. And it has happened with me also sometimes, that sometimes I have a particular plan and the plans get disrupted. So there are times when we are able to accept, when times we are not able to accept. So that happens because if our purpose is very narrow and specific, very narrow, this is what I want to do, and then that purpose is thwarted, we can't accept it. But if our purpose is something bigger, if my purpose is to remember Krishna, yes, I can speak and remember Krishna, I can hear and remember Krishna. But if my purpose is to prove to the world how clever I am, how learned I am, then if I am just one among 100 people sitting in the audience, he says, I can't prove that to anyone. I just become one among so many. So then it will be very difficult to accept. So in general, if we go towards a deeper or a bigger purpose, then acceptance becomes easier. This I'll talk about more in diligence, but this is the 3 levels at which we can accept. What are 3 levels? Powerlessness, temporariness, and purposefulness. So powerlessness, I give example that Like Gajendra, he realized, I just don't have the power. For temporariness, like we are in a crowded local, but it's a short journey. Purposefulness, I talked about how Ram's purpose was to serve his father, and also he gave Kaushalya the purpose that, no, don't see yourself as a victim and Dashrath as a victimizer. See that, you know, both of you are together in this. Your purpose is to serve him. So this was the second point. Any reflections, comments, questions about this? Yes, please.
In another lecture, I heard that Sri Ram, he had this other purpose in the sense that by the way of his avatar, he wanted to sort of actually go and visit the rishis in the forest and all that. And in fact, the deity that he had, that he used to worship every day, so he was, although he doesn't need to pray, but I have heard that he was praying that he gets that opportunity to go and mingle with all those rishis. Any thoughts?
Beautiful, yeah. So, is it that Ram also saw this as an opportunity? His purpose was to associate with the sages and learn from the sages? Yes. Actually, most of the reflections are stealing my future points. That's very beautiful. Actually, it's the courtiers in the kingdom, in the court, in the assembly, they say, this is so unfair. It's so terrible. And Ram says, no, what is terrible about it? He said that I have the opportunity to be an instrument in honoring my father's words. We are in a glorious dynasty where we have always honored our word. And I have opportunity to help my father honor his word. He says, I have opportunity to to see or to have my younger brother, Bharat, who is like my son, enthroned as the king. He says that every father dreams that his son become the king. So I have opportunity, even my youth, to see Bharat become enthroned like the king. And he says that for us who live in the world, we know that we need the association of the sages. But we don't get it till we retire and go to the forest. But I am so fortunate that in my youth, I am able to go to the forest and associate with the sages and enrich myself with the wisdom from them. So he says, I see auspiciousness everywhere. Where do you see unfairness? So it's a remarkably positive view. So he does say that. He does. Ram presents things in a way that will be appealing for everyone. Now, of course, we could say ultimately this is all his leela and he wants to go to the forest so that he can confront the demons and he can kill the demons. All that is true. But generally, when the avatars of the Lord come to this world, they don't always act like omniscient beings. In fact, most of the time, they act like normal beings. And sometimes they exhibit their omniscience or omnipotence. So therefore, Ram at this point doesn't say that, oh, I now got an opportunity to go to the forest, so I'll kill the demons. That's all going to happen. But at this stage, we are analyzing, Ram is also, as we know, he's an ideal human being. So how does he have this capacity to accept? So yes, that is also one way we can say the purpose of going and associating with the sages and learning from them. That's also something which gave him purpose. Thank you. Any other reflections? Yes, please.
In instances where there's powerlessness, especially in this world, then we don't have too much control. I think it is important to understand when to push and when to pull. With that understanding, sometimes we might accept the situation and then move on to something more better, and also get that purposefulness.
Yes, to know when to push, when to pull, when to accept. Thank you. It's difficult to understand that, but over a period of time, we understand it. There is that, what is it called, the serenity prayer, that, oh God, give me the wisdom to accept the things that I can't change. No, no, God, give me the serenity to accept the things I can't change, the courage to change the things that I can change, and the wisdom to know the difference. So that we'll talk about changing the things which you can't change, which can change in when you talk about diligence. So this was the second point. Any questions about this? Yes, please.
Just building on that, you were talking about acceptance and purposefulness. So we see that Ram had to show the purpose in Kaushalya. But in our lives, we might not be able to decipher a situation and realize the purpose behind it sometimes. So how do we train ourselves, or how do we see purpose so that the acceptance is at a higher level?
So, if we don't have anyone to show the purpose to us, then how do we find the purpose? Yes, that's why purposes exist at different levels of specificity. And we have to find out the right level of how to see things. Okay, this is abstract. Let me make it a little simpler. This is all, actually many of these points are coming as a part of the next part of the seminar, but I'll speak it now. See, for all of us, whenever something unexpected happens, whenever something unfavorable or unpleasant happens, we need to process it at the right level. Say, for example, if we are in an airplane and we are sitting on the seat and the person next to us is just putting their elbow on us, and they are just elbowing us and they are annoying us. Now, you say, now we could interpret this at various levels. We could say, this person has no manners. This person is so domineering. Or we could say, this airlines is so cheap. They have such small seats. Or we could say, maybe I have become overweight, I always keep eating too much. Or we could say that life always goes wrong for me. That same thing, we could interpret at different levels. I was at a seminar on spirituality and mental health in Connecticut. So there were people who had become addicts in different kinds of things. So they had come, and many of them were talking also, so I was talking with them. So now sometimes, some people were very depressed, some people were addicted. So I was talking with one woman, and young woman, so she was saying, you know, what triggered her depression? So she was a very intelligent student in the college. And along with studying in the college, she was also, to earn some money, by the way, she was also used to wait on tables in a restaurant there. So then one day, she was just carrying water for a customer, and somehow the glass of water slipped from her hands. It fell down. And she said, that one incident has made me feel I am so useless that I can't even carry a glass of water. What will I do with my life? If I can't carry a glass of water, I won't be able to do anything in my life. Now we say, okay, a glass of water slipped, just wipe the water and move on with life. So what happens when people get depressed? They take the smallest of incidents and give them the biggest of meanings. So intelligence means to address problems or to place issues in the most constructive context. So for example, if the water has slipped, if the glass has slipped. Now I could say that it could be because, you know, maybe the glass itself was slippery. Or maybe it could be because I did not hold it properly. Maybe it could be because I was inattentive. Maybe it could be because somebody had, the water floor was slippery, and in that process it slipped out of my hands. Maybe it could be because somebody else suddenly spoke to me and I got distracted. There could be so many reasons for that. So, for us, we could start from a very immediate explanation, we could go to a very broad explanation. And all of these may be true in different situations. But we need to place a issue in the most constructive context. Say, if somebody is working, say there's a devotee who is well known to build temples. So he is like a project in charge. There are traveling preachers and there are traveling temple constructors also. So they go from temple to temple, they construct temples. So I was talking with this, he had constructed a temple in America and then it came to India. And he was telling me, in India, you know, every single permission you have to get, it's such a headache. So now, India is so much tied by red tape. So now there was another devotee, he was working with another devotee. This other devotee, I talked with him, he said, you know, this person, instead of building the temple, is always complaining about India only. You know, if he doesn't like India, then why does he come here? You know, I'll build the temple, I don't need him over here. So what had happened, for this devotee, he has never been out of India. So the way India works, that's how he has always worked. So when problems come, he doesn't put it in the context of India at all. Yeah, this is how things are. You have to find a way ahead. But because for the other devotee, for him, he has a context outside India. So what happens? It's India. Now, it may or it may not be India, but if you are to build a temple in India, you have to deal with the things in India. So attributing all the problems to India, from this devotee's perspective, it may be true. But it is not constructive. Okay, if you think India is like that, then don't build a temple in India. If you want to build a temple in India, then stop attributing the problem to India. Find out some workable level of attribution. Okay, you need more contacts. Try to develop the contacts. You need to influence more, put more pressure, or whatever you need to do, you do that. So what happens is, we all need to frame whatever issue we are facing in the most constructive context. And that, sometimes we need to be in Sattvaguna to reflect on the situation. Sometimes we need somebody else in Sattvaguna to help us see it in the proper context. Sometimes it might just be that Krishna sometimes gives us that insight. But this framing that issue in a constructive context is important. So for that, it's also experience. Say if somebody gives a class for the first time, and then after they speak about Krishna and they give philosophy class, and somebody asks a question. And it's such a difficult question that they just can't answer anything. And they feel so embarrassed, they feel so defeated. And that person, yeah, I'll never give a class again. Now it could be that they may feel, I don't know enough. The people ask difficult questions, I won't be able to answer, so I won't give any classes. Now, okay, that particular question you could answer, you could frame it in that context, that you know, I don't know enough. But that may not be the most constructive thing. There are some people who delight in asking difficult questions. One time we did a 6-session course on the Bhagavad-Gita in Pune. So we're trying different models. Sometimes we would have one devotee giving all 6 sessions. And sometimes we had 6 devotees giving 6 sessions. And after that, we asked feedback. So, you know, how did you find it? Now, if we have different speakers giving different sessions, do you find it better or worse? So there's one person who wrote, it's very good because I can test the knowledge of all the speakers. So the same question you would ask all the 6 speakers and see how they answer it. So now, it might be that it's not that you don't know, it might be that the questioner might be a troublemaker. So the point is that we need to frame every issue that we face in the most constructive context. So if I'm not able to answer a question in a class, and I frame that issue in terms of my own incompetence, then I may become so discouraged that I may never give a class again. So that is framing the issue in a destructive context. But, okay, I talk with some other dudes, yeah, this person always keeps asking difficult questions. I sometimes go to temples and I am known sort of to answer questions. There are 2-3 temples where before I go to the temple, before I start a class itself, the organizer comes and tells me, you know, this person, these 2-3 people, they always ask crazy questions. So if they ask, they raise their hands, don't point to them. Now I say, I can't do that, because what happens is, in every question answer session, they're the first to raise hand. Then he said, no, you can answer their questions, but answer their questions privately. It just distract the whole mood. So now, here what has happened is that I'm given a particular context, or sometimes we answer a question and then they ask a counter question, and they answer a question, they ask a counter question, they just go on and on. And they may take over a whole question answer session. So now, if they give me this orientation, okay, then let's talk privately. So basically, either by our own intelligence or by intelligence got from consulting others, whatever issue we are facing, we need to frame it in the most constructive context. Here, it is not a right and wrong context. Because right and wrong become moral or judgmental issues. So for this devotee from America, temple constructor in India, he feels, there's so much red tape, so much bureaucracy over here. Well, you could say, is that right or is it wrong? Well, maybe it's right, as compared to India, America, there might be more bureaucracy. But that is not constructive. So rather than thinking of this in terms of the framing in terms of right and wrong, we see it in terms of constructive and unconstructive or destructive. So whatever issue we are facing, we place it in the most constructive context. Then we will get a sense of purpose. Okay. Say, if somebody is putting their elbow into my chest, and I think, life always treats me badly. Well, that's a destructive context. What can I do about it? But I can say, okay, maybe this person is overweight, and that's why that person is also uncomfortable. I just look around. Maybe there is a flight, some of the seats are empty. I ask the airline staff and shift somewhere else. So that's a simple solution. So basically, to have that sense of purposefulness, we need to place issues in the most constructive context. And that, so it's like, say right now, if I take a photo. Now, when I take a photo, in that photo, I can put the framing in such a way that I can see only one person over here. I can take the photo and framing in such a way I can see 10 people over here. I can take the framing in such a way that I can put 100 people over here. I can take the framing in such a way that maybe I can see this whole room with the 100 people over here. So now, if I want to tell someone, this person was there for this program, then maybe I'll take the framing of that person. If I want to show how attentive people were, then I might take a cross-section of 10 people, show how attentively, how eagerly they're hearing the class. If I want to show, how many people had come for the program, then I might show the whole audience. If I want to show someone, this is the kind of facility, nice facility for having satsang, then I might show the whole room with the people. So all of them are right. Right in the sense that what is the purpose? So we have to frame issues in the right context. In the most constructive context. So each context may be right for a particular way of dealing with it. So I'll talk about that purposefulness more. But this, either by our intelligence or by others' intelligence, we need to frame the issue in the most constructive context. Okay? Thank you. There's a question here. Yeah.
You mentioned about the acceptance or of powerlessness. Now, can also be understood as the acceptance or of helplessness, because in case of this Dasharma, for example, then in one way he was powerless, because though he had a power as a king, but at the same time he was also helpless because
is bound by his word, yes. So powerlessness and helplessness, I think both are same. Powerlessness and helplessness are the same. It's generally, when we say helpless, means that power means I don't have the power. Helpless means that I can't do anything, and even others can't do anything to help me. So it's help often has that context of others also involved in it. I'm in a helpless situation. So if somebody has got an incurable disease, then they're helpless at that time. So I don't think there's much difference between powerlessness and helplessness, broadly speaking. Okay. Any other questions? Okay. So I spoke 2 points till now. What are the first point? Accepting change is difficult, but if we don't accept it, our energy gets dissipated. And second point was? Acceptance through? Three aspects were? Powerlessness, temporariness, purposefulness. Yes. Thank you. And now, the last point I'll talk about is that acceptance is itself empowering. Often, we think of acceptance as giving up. Mm-hmm. If I accept, I'm giving up. Now, it may be like that, but it may not be like that also. So acceptance is empowering because it enables us to direct our energy constructively. How? Because acceptance means that wherever the energy is going to be uselessly directed, we stop doing that. Let me give you a couple of examples for this. Say, if you had to come for this program, and you were driving along, and then Google showed you two routes. So one was going to take 50 minutes, the other was going to take 55 minutes. And then the two are interchangeable in between also. But you take the 50-minute route. And then suddenly, maybe there's a traffic issue over there. 50 minutes, it suddenly becomes 75 minutes. Then what happens at that time? Okay, things have changed over here. So now if I don't accept it, hey, maybe Google is wrong. And I keep moving forwards. Then the traffic comes and you just don't move. Just don't move at all. Then what happens? It's just frustrating. But okay, I accept that this route is blocked now. I cannot go this way. Once I accept that I cannot go this way, then I can make some plan. Okay, maybe should I take the other route? Or should I just call and tell them that I'm going to be late? Or should I just start doing something right now over here, maybe hear something or prepare something? So acceptance stops the dissipation of our energy in directions which are useless. It is another way to understand this is that if something has happened which has already gone wrong, then if we don't accept it, it's not accepting some situation is like pressing the brake of our car very heavily. If the brake is pressed, then no matter how much accelerator we press, no matter how much fuel we expend, the car is not going to move forwards. So acceptance is like releasing the brake. So if there's no acceptance, then the car doesn't move forward at all. I sometimes speak at forums of where there are people with special needs. Somebody may have lost an eye, somebody lost a ear, somebody has lost a leg. So when I speak at such forums, after that when I talk with people, many times, not with everyone, but many people, what strikes me is that many of them are still fighting battles that have already been lost long ago. Hey, somebody has lost their eyes. It's for most of us, the prospect of losing our eyes itself is horrible. And for somebody who's born blind, okay, they live with it. But somebody who had eyes and lost them, it's extremely difficult. But that may have happened 10 years ago, and still they're resenting it. And then it's like, okay, it was terrible, but move on. It's over now. Resenting what had happened at that time, it's like, why did this happen? Accept it, then you can move on. So when, after one such meeting, when I was reflecting, that I don't remember, although I have polio and I need to use crutches for walking, I don't remember myself ever being resentful like this. So then I look back, and then it struck me that one reason I was able to accept myself was because my parents accepted me. My parents never ever made me feel as if I was deficient in any way. That I was, either my leg was a burden to them, that or I was a burden to them. Okay, this was the way I was, they just accepted me. And because they accepted me, I was able to accept myself. So now when somebody sees me, the crutches is the first thing that they see about me. And now for me, as obviously I can't walk without crutches, but I hardly ever think about the crutches. For me, the crutches are like my glasses. I can't function without them, but I don't think much about them. So it's like, okay, I need this to see, I need that to walk. But there's not much emotional energy that is spent on it. Of course, a lot of emotional energy is spent when it doesn't work. Say if the crutches break down or the glasses break down, that is an inconvenience. But otherwise, there's not much thought about it. So the point I'm making is that acceptance is empowering. Because I can see that for these people, not all of them, some of the people with special needs are also remarkably accepting. But some of them, there's so much energy is going in that resentment, in that refusal to accept. So this is a very important shift that we need to make. Acceptance is not giving up. Acceptance is not, in a sense, accepting defeat. Actually, acceptance is empowering. Yes, it is, we could say, accepting defeat in one battle. But we are accepting defeat in one battle so that we can fight another battle. And that's why this will be the main theme of my next class. But I'll mention that the broad point of the theme. And to put something behind us, we need to put something ahead of us. To put something behind us. Sometimes just leave it, you know, put it behind you now. But we can't put something behind us unless we put something ahead of us. So we can't accept that, okay, I've lost this battle, if we don't have any other battle to fight. If there's nothing else to do for us, then we just talk about, this terrible thing happened. But if we have another battle to fight, okay, this is over, let me move on to this. So we need to, if we see that acceptance is not accepting defeat in the war of life. It is accepting defeat in one battle so that we can shift our energy to another battle. So acceptance is empowering because it stops our energy from being dissipated in the battle that can't be fought. That is already lost, that's already over. And that generally, if anything we accept, see, I talked about acceptance because of powerlessness. If we accept it with negativity in it, then some energy goes in that. A lot of energy goes in that. Now, we may accept it because of negativity. But there is a difference between accepting it because of negativity and accepting it with negativity. If this seems too complicated, I'll make it simple. See, something bad may happen. Something negative may happen, and because of that, we may have to accept it. Now, we didn't want that bad thing to happen, obviously. Nobody wants bad things to happen. So because of that bad thing happening, we have to accept it. So we made a plan to go out somewhere for outing, and just before that, we get flu and we fall sick. And then we are lying in our bed. Now, because of that negative thing that happened, we got the flu, we have to accept it. We just can't do anything, we're powerless. But if we are thinking, why couldn't I go? I'm accepting it, but I'm accepting it with negativity. I didn't want to do it. I wouldn't want to stay in bed. but I have to do this, but what can I do in the bed now? Okay, I'm in the bed, what can I do in this situation? So when to see acceptance as empowering, we have to focus on what we can do instead of what we can't do. I repeat this, that to accept, we need to shift our focus from what we can't do to what we can do. And this might seem like just a simple point. Yes, but actually, it said that common knowledge is not common action. Common knowledge is not common action. Just because everybody knows it doesn't mean everybody is going to do it. And I have found this very helpful at times. That, you know, what I can't do instead of what I can do. I just shift that. So, once I was traveling in America, I was going from Seattle to Boston. And in Boston, I had a program in the evening. So we went to the airport, and along the way, somehow, the traffic was very bad. We also started a little late. And different devotees have different driving competence also. So sometimes we assume that whoever is driving is a good driver. And yeah, maybe everybody is a good driver, but not everybody is equally good. But sometimes the devotees just get confused, they get lost. And then, so basically, because of multiple factors, I ended up reaching late. And we missed the flight. And then that evening, I had a program in Boston. And I was so annoyed. Now, generally, when such things happen, either I can blame myself that I started late. I can blame the driver. Nobody was driving me. You know, why did you take this route and not that route? Or I can just blame the situation, whatever it is. Actually, another thing that happened was, we reached there, but for me, I need a wheelchair assistant. So the wheelchair assistant didn't come for 15, 20 minutes. And because of that, we missed the flight. So I could blame the wheelchair assistant also, or the airline staff for not sending the wheelchair assistant in time. So then now I could blame any people. I was so annoyed. But then, as I was thinking about it, so I had an opportunity, I could take another flight after 4 or 5 hours. But then I would be in flight when I was having the program. So then I called up the devotee and I said, what can you do? They will check different flights. There's no flight going across. Because what happens is 3 hours ahead in the time zone. So you can't reach in time anyway. So then they said they had organized some, they had invited some special guests and they really wanted me to come. I mean, planning their program. So then as I was thinking, what can I do? I just, somehow that God thought, okay, I just can't do this. I can't do this. What can I do? And then I asked them that, now, is it okay that if I'm not able to reach physically, we can do a class on Skype? And he said, hey, we've never done a class like this. Yeah, I said, there can be first time for everything. What do you think about it? So he talked with 2-3 devotees, and he said, yes, we can try it. So then I had an opportunity to go that evening at 5 o'clock. But then I decided, I asked the airlines, can you give us a ticket on the next day? The next morning at 5 o'clock. So they said, yes, we can do that. So then I came back, and I did the class. And it went on very nicely. The internet was very good. And we did the class, a lot of good question answers. And then it struck me that just that one question, what can I do? Instead of, why can't I do this? 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 Why is this not working? Okay, what will work now? What will work now? So what can I do now? Just if we shift that, then we will see acceptance as empowering. So this is where, if you consider Ram's situation, at one level, from his father's perspective, he saw that I have to do my duty to my father, whether it is becoming a king or whether it is becoming an exilee. But okay, if I have to become an exilee, what can I do in this situation? What I can do is, I can associate with the forest sages. Now, Ram had earlier also been in the forest. When was that? When Vishwamitra had asked him to come to the forest. That was a brief time, but he had been in the forest before. So, because of that, he saw that, and he said, yes, I can. He knew about forest sages. He loved to associate with them. He said, I can associate with them. So he said, yes, this is a good opportunity for me to do that. So in every situation, either I can keep asking the question, why can't I do this? Why is this not working? Or I can ask the question, what can I do in this situation? And if we ask this question, what can I do? Then we will find that acceptance is not so much about giving up. It is about finding a way within that situation. And that sense, acceptance can be empowering. So that is the third point. Acceptance can empower us if we shift our vision from what we can't do to what we can do. So any one question? We have time? Okay, fine. So if you have any questions, maybe you can note them down. And I'll summarize and then we can have a break. So I spoke today on the topic of Ram at home in exile. So the theme I was speaking is, how did Ram accept this terrible adversity of being the king to suddenly having nothing except his own life with him? So I talked about acceptance and diligence taking us to transcendence. So I focused on acceptance today. And I spoke 3 points. The more unexpected and the more massive the change, the more difficult it is to accept it. But if we accept it, we can. If we don't accept it, we waste our energy. Then second point I talked about is that, so in that I give many examples. Second point was acceptance can be because of powerlessness, temporariness, and purposefulness. And we can find a purpose if we place a issue in the most constructive framing, in the most constructive context. And last point was, acceptance can be empowering if we shift our vision from why can't I do this to what can I do. So in the next session, I'll talk about diligence leading to transcendence, that how we can get that sense of purposefulness. And how we can apply that sense of purposefulness in different difficult situations in our life. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.